Okay, how about that? How about that? I believe we got sound because I'm talking in my own ear. I have to mute myself. Cool. Hey, welcome everybody. Happy Sunday. Yes. Okay. So I got YouTube chat over there. Everyone in the live room, you should have your cameras on. You should have your microphones ready to go in case you have a question. Also, in case I have a question for you. So anyways, welcome to Off the Charts with Wayne McDonell. This is an opportunity for currency traders around the world to get together 90 minutes before the market opens with the overriding goal of kind of just getting warmed up to talk about fundamentals, to talk about trader psychology, just shoot the breeze about being a trader, about being an investor. And then, of course, ultimately, you're at your desk anyways. So by the time this webinar is over, pa-ching, you hear that awesome sound of MT4 clicking online. And it says, hey, bro, Auckland, New Zealand's ready for you. Let's throw down your trades for the week, throw down your trades for the month, throw down your trades for the day. So right off the bat, we win because I get you to be at the right place at the right time and maybe with a little malice aforethought ready to go in here. So happy Sunday. Hope you're doing all right. Hey, if you're in the main room, guys, it says in the email, you have to have your camera on. Otherwise, you should be over there on YouTube. Okay. All right. So you do have sound over there now, right? How is it? Is it good? I want to, sometimes it's hard to tell which microphone it's using. And it's still difficult. Let me just double check. Hang on. I got a open sound settings and it is sound output, sound input. Yeah, it should be good, right? Yeah, it's perfect. So there's a built-in microphone on the camera, but I'm using this thing. So, and then when you talk, even if I'm way back here, I should be able to hear you perfectly because I have a monitor into the mic. How cool is that? And of course I look all fat and chubby. Why do I look all fat and chubby? Like maybe I'm fat and chubby. So anyways, hey, happy Sunday, everybody. Hey, look, I got a new toy. This is my waterproof JBL speaker, Bluetooth speaker. Isn't that awesome? With the FX Bootcamp logo and camouflage. And the cool thing is the logo actually looks like fabric because it's built on the fabric. So anyways, it's pretty cool. Just a heads up. So I listen to Bloomberg Radio in the shower now with this thing. How cool is that? All right. So today, hang on. You know what? I got the speaker going in the other room. I need to mute that. Hang on. Hang on. You should be able to hear me though as I'm walking. That's the cool thing about the lav. And why is this loud? Anyways, I don't know why I was doing that. I think it was muted, except the sound was still coming out. Sorry about that. All right, so in our tradition, I have coffee today instead of wine or whiskey, so hopefully you're not upset at me about that. But I will be smoking a cigar. All right, so we'll be back. You can still hear me fine. All right, sorry about that. And I'm not sure why the other people logged in and then didn't turn on the cameras. It says it clearly on the email. Come on, guys. Cool. All right. So today I am smoking my aged Monte Cristo. So we'll get that all fired up and then we'll get into the plan. The plan today is going over the calendar. going on, Mikey?
How's it going?
Oh, pretty good. Did you bring a cigar or a cocktail with you?
Brought some scotch with me. I'm inside, so I can't do the cigar today.
Yeah, I'm worried that it's going to rain on me. So anyways, we'll go through the calendar for the week. I started reading Barron's magazine in preparation, then I realized it's last week's magazine, so I ran up and I got this week's. So we'll have to go through that one live together, so we'll figure it all out. And then, of course, we're only about an hour and 15 minutes away from the market opening. So you got some trade plans, Mike? You're all lined up, ready to go?
I don't know. I might take it kind of easy, maybe just do some demo stuff the next week or two here with all the crazy going on. So,
well, tell me about the crazy. What crazy going on?
Just the run up to the election and then afterwards. So,
okay, cool. No, I understand that.
You know, as it relates to that, I'm like, lately, you were kind of talking about it on Thursday a little bit. I watched it on replay, but I'm kind of wondering about the, you know, I feel like the equities market, you know, kind of a lot of times leads this whole thing versus, you know, unless you have rate decisions or something like that goes on. And, you know, where the market's pretty toppy right now and it keeps, you know, hitting the top all the time, then, you know, coming back a little bit and then going back up again and stuff. It's hard to, you know, unless you're going to sit there and babysit it all the time, sort of, it's hard to ride that wave out, I'm finding.
Yeah. Well, you know, one of it is, you know, there's a question, does the stock market lead the currency market or does the currency market lead the stock market?
Right.
Well, it all comes down to the Fed. It always does. So the only reason the stock market's going up is because of the Fed.
Right.
I mean, that's it. And that's going to continue.
Yeah, that was a learning lesson for me this year, I have to say, from what you said back in June. And, you know, you pull your charts out and you see the slope upwards from there. I feel like it's a little more challenging right where we're at right now, because I guess I don't feel confident it's going to go up at least at that same slope from here, at least for a while anyway.
What do you mean, like the stock market?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, the current behind that is the monetary policy. The monetary policy right now is designed to make the stock market going up. Okay, that's all they can do. So, I mean, how about this? What is the prime number one most common monetary policy that a central bank could do? What is it that they manipulate to get the results that they're looking for? What's the sort of standard operating procedure in the normal market for a central bank?
Well, the first thing is interest rates.
That's it.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So what can the Fed possibly do now to interest rates? Can they lower it? Right. Typically, when the stock market's doing bad, they lower interest rates, lower interest rates, lower interest rates. And right at some point, it's supportive. But in this case, they got it to zero and it still wasn't effective, right?
Right. Yeah. Or it doesn't seem like it's going to be going forward anyway.
Well, they're not going to go negative. A reserve currency can't do it. And right now, we do have inflation in the United States. Let's say, I don't know, it's 1.5 or 2% or whatever your measure is. The thing is, our current interest rate being 0.25 or less, in real terms, we have negative interest rates already. We have real interest rates are already negative. So there's no need to go further negative. And things get complicated for the Fed being a reserve currency. So they can't really go negative like Europe and Japan. So once that got to, so now they can't use that policy, but that's the number one most common tool the Fed has. So if they can't lower interest rates, then the next thing is what?
Quantitative easing.
Monetizing the debt. That's all it is. So when that happens, it pushes up asset prices. And by asset prices, I mean real estate and I mean stocks. And truly bonds too, right? Because they're actually buying bonds and pushing up the prices and dropping interest rates on the bonds because they're manipulating the whole curve. So as long as we're sort of in this process, the stock market will go up. Maybe not every day, but generally speaking, that is the trend.
Yeah, I'd have to say the whole thing, when everything fell apart back in March and kind of stuff like that, I'm like, wow, this seems really bad and I don't see a way up. But then the whole thing that's been kind of the mantra since then is, you know, don't bet against the Fed. I mean, they're going to win. They're going to win, I guess. So that was a big learning thing for me this time, I'd have to say.
Well, that and the other thing, like if you're buying a stock if you're buying real estate, all you're doing is buying a cash flow. I mean, those companies still have to produce a cash flow, right? So you don't want to buy a dead company that's running out of money and has no cash flow. But as long as the Fed is doing, you know, quantitative easing or some form of debt monetization, the whole purpose of that is to push up asset prices. Now, the scary thing is that's what happened in the 1930s. The Fed lowered interest rates to zero and then started buying government debt. And, there was a limitation. they're not exactly the same. It's not the same situation. It's not a fair example because the Fed is structurally different than it used to be back then. And we're not tied to gold anymore like we were. And we are the reserve currency because we didn't have the Bretton Woods system. That came along, I think, 1944. So that didn't happen in 1933. So it's a different world, but it's still interesting that this is a normal process. Like another way of saying it is we're repeating history. Like, yeah. We're so smart and brilliant, right? No, we're just doing what we did in the 1930s. But it was pretty bad by the end of the 30s. But we're not going in depression. But it's an interesting parallel.
Yeah, it's been eye-opening. Just cause, I mean, we've kind of seen it happen twice now, 2008 and now. I mean, different scenarios. But I guess being so close together, it's a little, and within my experience, I guess it's been a little easier to learn from. So,
well, and it's funny too, because it used to be, you know, you would have to analyze an individual stock to find out its future cash flow versus current cash flow and its competitiveness in the market to get the cash flow. And you could use some sort of multiple to come up with a valuation or some other model. Now, really, that's what people were thought of, or that's what people were taught in school. But what we're finding out is what's more important is really the economic cycle these companies are in, and the monetary policy that the central bank is carrying out. That's even more important. You know, it's even more important.
I agree.
So I would watch, you know, but I'm a macro guy, right? So that would be my opinion, that the central bank and its policy dictates everything. But like you said, you saw it in 2008, now you're seeing it repeated. You had very mediocre, if not disastrous, economic conditions, but the stock market went up. The stock market went up, you know, and you're like, wow, that's weird. You're like, yeah, so you shouldn't be trading what you thought was the important information and really focus on what you do know now, and it's the policy that the central bank carries out.
Yeah. I think that's been made abundantly clear this time, particularly.
Well, wait till there's going to be another downturn. Most likely it'll be an economic cycle downturn, which is absolutely totally normal part of capitalism, right?
Right.
And so there will be one in the next 10 to 12 years, let's say. This one was an exogenous shock. It had to do with, you know, obviously the coronavirus. So, but it did the job. It lowered prices and it did kill bad companies. And that's what's supposed to happen in a downturn, right?
Right.
So we kind of went through that process, but there will be another process in the distant future. And you'll be ready. You'll know what to do.
All right.
Yeah. All right, well, let's go through the calendar. Let's go through the calendar brought to you today by Forex.today. All right, cool. So what's going on in the world next week? Nothing on Monday. Tuesday, durable goods. Now remember, durable goods is quite volatile, and it's an important one to watch, but I don't even care about it. Hey, Jim, you looking strong and fit and healthy? COVID doesn't keep that guy down. He's in boss mode. That's cool. All right, so what's the next one? Aussie CPI. It was negative 1.9. Like, it's not even the right word to call it CPI. It should be like CPDI or like, you know, disinflation. But Australia is going for better than negative 2%. Good job, Australia. So anyways, that's important for the Aussie dollar. So that's on Tuesday. Really, it's Wednesday for Australia, but Tuesday night here. Then we go on to Wednesday, and we got a Canadian interest rate decision and statement, of course. And I would suggest that you download the statement and read through it, because they're going to talk about Canada. But they're also going to talk about the United States and global macroeconomics in general, and of course, their exposure to COVID risk. But by far, the largest trading partner for Canada is the United States, so we can learn something about the U.S. as well. Can you guys hear the air conditioner in the background?
Doesn't seem bad.
Good. This house has like 4 or 5 units. It's just crazy. You can't get away from them. I looked at a house on Saturday. It's got 9 chimneys.
Wow.
But if you've ever had a house with a chimney, they all leak. But I'm looking at it, I'm like, so it just occurred to me, I didn't count how many HVAC systems that sucker's got. I only have 1, 2, 3, I only have 4 heat exchangers or air conditioners or whatever. That one probably has more. I'm like, ugh.
Is it all HVAC or is it fireplaces? You're gonna need to live next to a forest too to use all of them.
Yeah, well, the interesting thing about that house is it looks like it's 200 years old, but it's 30 years old. So I kind of like that. It's sort of like buying a 1969, Chevy Camaro SS, but it's got modern brakes on it. You know, it's got a modern suspension. You're like, nice, this is good. But anyways. Okay, so Canadian interest rate decision. They even have a press conference, so you can watch that, you can read it, you can attend it, you can do whatever you want. But I would say do something. Read about the monetary policy. Then later that day, like quite a bit later, it's Japan's turn. They're doing their monetary policy statement. So if you want to be a cool kid and impress everyone, download the Bank of Japan meeting minutes. Or in this case, monetary policy statement, right? Like, who does that? Well, us, right? Our professionals. We're professionals. This is what we do. Distinguishes us. Yeah. Men in Action says, yeah, we do. It distinguishes us from everybody else. It's the prime reason to do it. I mean, it's all about slipping it into the conversation with your clients, right? You're like, oh, you know, well, I was just reading the Bank of Japan meeting minutes and something really occurred to me. Or I thought about you. That's a nice one. It's like, well, you thought about me? Really? Really? Yeah, I did. All right. So then Thursday, we got, of course, weekly jobless claims, European and unemployment, whatever. Because Friday, I think it is, there's an there's another report on employment in Europe. So anyways, so Thursday is GDP out of the United States to look backwards and say, hey, way back in history, this is what our economy did. Like, never that interested in GDP. It's too forward-looking. But what I always recommend to you guys is you should take the components of GDP, things like consumption, and try to use that to look forward and figure out GDP that will be released 3 months from now. And I think you'll be better off. Let's see, Friday, European GDP, PCE out of the US. I like PCE because it's what the Fed uses for a gauge of inflation and productivity and all these things. So right now, PCE in the US year over year is 1.6. I like to look at that as inflation instead of CPI, and think of that. So, you know, we have inflation higher than what even a 10-year T-note, even a 30-year bond doesn't pay 1.6%, right? So in reality, we already have negative interest rates, if you want to think about it. So like, someone could argue like, oh, I made 10% in the stock market this year. Then you could say, oh, well, did you know the dollar lost 4%? And we have 2% in inflation. So what was the real return on the investor that made 10% on the S&P 500? Well, minus inflation, minus the loss, purchasing power of your currency, son, you only made 4%. You're like, that's not 10%, that's 4%. You know, so that's why you need to, you know, what we would say, if you're an accredited investor that already has a balanced portfolio, you should have an alternative investment like a Forex, because we can do better than 10% in a year. And you should have something, you know, some sort of asset class in your balanced portfolio that can kind of bump up the whole portfolio without adding any more volatility. So, you know, 10% in the stock market these days is not enough. Especially if you're thinking about one day you're going to take money out of the stock market and you're going to buy, you know, income producing real estate, but real estate's going up 5% a year. Like, by the time like you take care of your currency devaluation is what it is, and you and loss of inflation, you're not earning enough to even just keep up with the real estate prices, right? And you probably earn more income by owning an apartment building than you would owning a dividend paying stock or an income producing bond, right? You probably, if you looked at your apartment building and looked at the rent minus your expenses, so your net operating income is some sort of yield, and then you would have to then discount it further. You can discount it because you have to most likely have a mortgage, so you have your financing costs and all that kind of stuff, and you can discount it further to say, well, I could have just invested in the stock market. You know, I mean, you can analyze it the way you want, but I bet you anything at the end of it, you're still probably making more money on the real estate. But
and the mortgage is really leveraged because you're still getting the income from that.
Then the more you leverage, I mean, it's a good point, Joseph. The more you leverage, the higher your returns are going to be, right? Banks will only let you go 80% if it's your home. 70% is more common if it's commercial real estate. But then another way to leverage up is out of that 30% you have to put down to own the property. I mean, first of all, the bank is going to lend you the money, 70% of the cash they're going to give you to own the real estate. And you only have to pay them, what, 4% a year? Like, that's your biggest partner? And they only want 4% a year? No, they have first right. You have to pay them before you pay anyone else. But you're like, for 4%, you're going to give me 80% of the money? Hell yeah. So you want to maximize that for sure. Because let me tell you, if you're going to bring in investors for your other 30%, they're going to want a lot more than 4%. They're going to want 20%, right? And they're going to want to get paid first. And, you know, all that kind of stuff. And if you make more money, they're going to want more money. If you do a really good deal in real estate and you do really well and your rents go up and the value of the property goes up and all that kind of stuff, your income goes up, the bank says, oh, that's really good for you. Give me my 4%. So that's a partner you want. But that's a good way to leverage up. But you see these real estate deals where the actual person controlling the property only has 5% in. You know, so if you do a really good job, you could probably get a 20% return. But dude, we can blow the doors off 20% on Forex. So at the end of the day, it's all stupid compared to what we do. But when you get too big for your own britches, you need to diversify. And I'll trade an income for another income. if there's one income like Forex, I'm responsible for every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's the only thing, and it's all on your shoulders. Like, oh my God. But if you just buy an apartment building for $3 million, you know, and the bank gives you money on top of that, and then and in exchange after all of this, you get income whether you get out of bed or not, you're like, okay, that's a good way to diversify. Because, you know, we know as Forex traders, to have a reasonable life, you don't need $30 million in your Forex account. But it'd be nice to have a $30 million net worth. So anyways. So I made a summary here. This week, there are three pieces of news out of the U.S. That's the most news, the relevant news that I pulled out. So I think the U.S. dollar is going to be a good mover this week. Oh, Jen's got his boot camp cup. Was that a boot camp cup? You did do it, didn't you? Yeah, I got mine. Yeah.
I'm jealous.
Yeah, well, you got to be careful, though. I don't know if that's licensed, so. I put a store on the Forex.today YouTube channel. So now what I can do is I'll put a store on the FX Bootcamp one and then put up the cups and stuff. So, but Jim's been bugging me, I don't know, for 10 years. He's like, I want a hat. Give me a hat. I'm like, I'd love to give you a hat, except I don't have any more hats. Like, I used to do these conferences where I'd show up to a conference and I got like these beautiful button down embroidered shirts and stuff, like not cheap junk. And I'm giving it out to all the boot campers and stuff. And they're all long gone. They're just all long gone. But I'm glad you got yourself a good cup. Okay. USD. So we got durable goods, GDP, PCE.
I can't find one on eBay.
What's that?
I can't even find the hat on eBay.
No, try Sotheby's. okay, Aussie, one piece of news, that's CPI. CAD, two pieces of news, interest rate decision, GDP. Okay, that's interesting. Yen, one news, but it's an interest rate decision. Euro, two pieces of news, one is interest rate decision, one is GDP. So euro's going to move a bit, CAD's going to move a bit, dollar's going to move a bit. Okay. The other thing, of course, we're looking for stimulus. And what else are we looking for? I guess I don't think if they make a Supreme Court decision, if that's going to affect us or not. But probably not. But anyways. Oh, speaking about your cup, Peter. What's that?
More information on Brexit or?
Oh, do you think there'll be news on Brexit?
I don't know. They keep talking it up, but it's kind of like the stimulus thing too. It's more complicated.
I think I will wait for it to happen. And I'll know. The chart will tell me. I'm like, oh my God, look at that. So I'll just wait. Jim. How about that? That's a waterproof JBL speaker. Yeah. Just got that the other day. So now I can sit and listen to Bloomberg in the shower while I meditate. Cool. All right.
You need so earlier room for your store.
Yeah. Well, that was $50 though. Like no one's going to want that. All right. So I started reading this Barron's magazine to prepare for today, and then I realized it's not this week's magazine. So you guys want to, how about a flash from the past? I since have run up and got the new Barron's. But I did find something before I realized the mistake I was making. How about this? Barron's interviewed a bunch of professional investors. And these investors say they're bullish on U.S. prospects for U.S. stock markets over the next 12 months. So we're talking about this. Professional investors think the stock market's going to go up. By the way, how do stock investors get paid? They get people to buy the stocks. Right? So they're like, hey, is the stock market going to go up? Like, yeah. Yes. Even when it's crashing, they're going to tell you it's going to go up. It's the only way they get paid. But nonetheless, here's the interesting thing. Do you expect it to increase or do you expect to increase or decrease your net holdings of the following asset classes in the next 6 months? The survey asked them about five. Okay, they asked them about five different asset classes. Do you think you're going to hold more or less of each of these? You guys want to hear what they said? The U.S. stock market. Most, and it looks like a 60%, I think is how to read this. There's a 60%. Let me make sure I'm reading this properly. Let's say 60%. I think it's that way. 60% of the respondents said they will hold more of the U.S. stock market in their portfolio in 6 months, which means it's going to go up modestly. Sorry, I got to keep this going. But you already know that I've outlined at least the Forex market, what's going to happen in the next 6 months, and we've already modeled that. Generally up until the early part of the year, and then generally down, and then generally flat. So we already know that, right? So like, oh, good. So at least we don't disagree with the big money, right? Now, how about this? European stocks. What do you guys think? Are these guys going to hold more or less European stocks over the next 6 months? Jim says down. Anyone else want to take a guess?
I would say more.
A little more. A little more. Okay? Not much more, but a little more. Now, I would almost like to have these overlap. When the stock market in the United States is over expensive, it's a good time to start buying European stocks. Okay? It's a better deal. I'd tiptoe from one to the other, really. Right? So when one is failing, you buy it low, and then the other one failing, whatever. Okay, how about this? Japanese stocks. Increase their portfolio of Japanese stocks or decrease their portfolio of Japanese stocks in the next 6 months? Jim says thumbs down.
I'm going to go with down because of the automotive industry.
Well, okay, help me out understanding that.
The Japanese automotive industry has got just hammered because of lack of vehicles being built and transportation issues and everything.
So is that COVID related?
Yeah, I think that's going to continue to drag on their market for a while.
Okay.
I've got to think global money is going to continue to flow into the U.S. market.
Okay. Well, these guys, the big money, say significant decrease in the holding of Japanese stock. Yeah, significant. No, not just a little bit. Significant.
Yeah.
Well, which is interesting because who already owns 70% of the Nikkei, the Japanese Nikkei? The Japanese government, the central bank, the Bank of Japan. Like, there's going to be nobody left, right? Nobody left. This is why, like, I don't think a central bank should be doing it that way. So right now in the United States, we have quantitative easing. The central bank buys treasuries and puts it on the balance sheet. And the money goes into the real economy. Okay, it's kind of dangerous. You're monetizing the government's debts, kind of. You're not really, because if the government gave the Fed the IOU, the bond, and the Fed gave the government money, and there was no one else in between, the money doesn't go anywhere to the government. So that's a big, big, big no-no. Think of like Austria 1940s, right? Germany 1945, it was just, the currency went to nothing, right? Think of Zimbabwe, okay? This is a little different because the Fed doesn't buy treasuries from the government. It buys it from a bond dealer who buys it from the government. So they just make rich people super fabulously rich, but at least the money enters the market. but buying a stock, I mean, it perpetuates forever, right? The stock doesn't end. It doesn't mature like a bond. There's no way to get out of it. You're like, I've read these numbers, and I don't know where they come from. So there's the caveat. But 70% of the Japanese stock market is owned by the central bank. And how do you unwind that? I don't know. But if everyone's leaving, it's only going to go up, right? So according to this, 6 months from now, the Bank of Japan is going to own 80% of the stock market. Like, it's going to be 100% one day. Like, wow.
Did they do that intentionally, or is that, you know, because of the financial issues they've had over the last couple decades? Or
All of this was new. I don't know why they did that. There was a time when I was very, 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 very happy with Japan. They elected a prime minister that says he'll do whatever it takes, you know, to get Japan back on its feet. And then they had an election where they essentially, like, the Japanese Congress and the Japanese Senate all were elected with the same thing in mind and directly worked with the prime minister to do it. And they recruited a central banker who was also on board the same plan. So imagine if the U.S. government had a president, had a Senate, had a Congress, and a central bank all banding together to accomplish one goal. I'm like, oh, that is truly amazing. And then politics got in the way, and as they were spending this money to save the Japanese economy, then they jacked up taxes at the same time, which makes no sense, because you just shot yourself in the foot. But you just bought $200 running shoes, right? Like, why did you do that? So I don't know. And I gave up right then and there. They were doing something beautiful and unique. It'd take 1,000 years for America to be able to pull something off like that. Like, so how Japan did it, I'm not sure. And then they ruined it. They ruined it. They just absolutely ruined it. So why did they buy stocks? It had to be during that mental breakdown. Someone said, hey, the Fed's buying bonds. Why don't we buy stocks? Stocks are not bonds. So anyways, that was terrible. What a terrible move. So, let's finish this out. Sorry. Chinese stocks, slight increase. Slight. Almost as many people that are buying in are getting out. So think of, like, geopolitical risk, retaliation for Huawei or something, right? So it's getting complicated and muddy. But this is what happens when superpowers get close together. So do you remember I said I wanted to write a book, and I mentioned all these brilliant minds over the last 500 years of Western civilization? One of the guys I said was Gauss. And nobody knows who Gauss is, right? He's not an economist. He's not a financier. He would take specimens and put them in a petri dish, like bacteria or amoebas or something. And he'd put them in, and he'd do different experiments to see what would happen. So imagine now you have two superpowers living in the same petri dish. Okay? If they're fighting over one thing, like food, they will kill each other. But if you create different needs, what will happen is they'll find a symbiotic relationship and they'll find balance. And we're kind of getting there, where it's going to be China and the United States in the same petri dish. And there are different rules of how to make these two organisms survive and thrive, or inevitably lead to one killing the other or them killing each other. And that's why I'm like, that would be a good chapter in a book. And then tie that into investing, or in this case, maybe it's macroeconomics, where I compare the rise or the catch-up of China to the United States, and now there's two superpowers. And it can get dangerous. So, like, most people don't understand why Japan bombed Pearl Harbor. It's the same thing that would happen in a petri dish if you put bacteria in there. And one has sort of a dominance over the other. In this case, it was the United States. And then the United States says things like, we're cutting you off of gasoline, because remember, they don't have any energy. We're going to cut you off of gasoline because we're going to hoard this for our own war. Oh, and we're going to cut you off from rubber. These are two massive, massive imports. Like, Japan needed this stuff. Like, what are you talking about? We will die. We have a long-term partnership. You said you were even going to pay for our debt when you rebuilt our economy. This is before World War II, right? We're talking about way back in history. And so Japan had no recourse but to fight back. You know, like, you can't do this, right? They were desperate. And same thing, like, the English converted their navy from coal-fired ships to oil-fired ships. And so suddenly Germany, the other superpower in Europe, said, oh my God, they're in a way out different technology than we are, right? This technology advance that they have over us is critical, absolutely critical. And so Germany looked at all its it didn't have access to oil. So it called up Baghdad and said, okay, we want to buy all your oil. And so they created a partnership and they started to build the Baghdad to Berlin Railroad. War. Why? The English essentially cut off Germany from what they needed to survive, because if Germany didn't have that oil, they could not compete and England was killing them. And it's the same thing, like, you know, like in that case, maybe the catalyst was the oil. But the thing is, one superpower is really afraid of the other, even though they're bigger. So they'd get this technological advance, and then they cut the other one off so they could never be a threat. Well, now you have to retaliate, right? You're forced into this. So it's very interesting when you look at macroeconomics, how things are like that. And so when we start going into trade wars and then, you know, pointing fingers like Huawei and TikTok, they're all spying tools, and you start cutting people off from these things, one of two things will happen. It'll get ugly, or China will just get better technology and the United States will fall behind and they'll grow old. And then China will have the capability of cutting us off. So I think they better, this is why I like capitalism, by the way. You want a symbiotic relationship where you both get rich by working with each other. And if you're getting rich and everybody's happy and fat and lazy, there's no need to go to war. You don't want to go to war. It's too expensive. It changes everything. Plus, you might lose all what you have. So we got to get to a point where we're playing nicer with each other. But it's normal for China to the United States to kind of, China's kind of scary to Americans because they don't really understand it. And then it's a threat to their own well-being. So now you're going to fight. And so there's a way to do it right. And there's a way to do it wrong. And Gauss figured it out a long, long time ago. And I'd like to write those rules, because he's got like very specific rules. If you do this, the weak one dies. If you do this, the strong one dies. If you do this, both will die. And if you do this, they will both live. They'll find a way. Right? And another example are warblers, the little birds, and they live in a pine tree. Have you ever walked by a pine tree and it's practically buzzing and you can hear 1,000 chirps in there? Did you know they live on different branches depending on their symbiotic relationship with the other? And they have different jobs and they eat different food and they do different things? Because if it was just 1,000 warblers in a tree, they would fight each other. Go find your own tree. Instead, they band together and say, well, you're going to be on that branch and you're going to specialize in this thing. And I'll be on this other branch and I'll specialize in that. And there literally could be 20 different specialized warblers in one tree. So they found a way to not kill each other and they all get a great tree. It's kind of interesting. So I'd like to apply that to macroeconomics and geopolitical scenarios. Okay, last one, emerging stocks. Emerging markets, basically.
I don't know. I'm not sure. Are they going to have access to, after this, are they going to have access to credit and stuff to rebuild, or are they going to struggle with that? Or
maybe. I mean, the nice thing is, there are still people out there that are searching for yield. So if they want to lend money, they might lend it to South Africa and pick up 6%. Because right now, if you can get 1.5%, you're a genius. The issue is, that's an old model. We should not even be thinking about yield anymore. It's all about tradability. Like gold, for example. Gold doesn't provide a yield. In fact, it has a negative yield, because if you have physically owned gold, you have to store it somewhere, right? So it has a negative yield. You have to pay it rent, or you have to pay rent for it, right? You have to put it in a vault, and that guy charges you money for the vault and the security cameras, which is fantastic because you don't do anything, right? What a great job that is. Like, so what do you do for a living? I own a vault. People put stuff in it. It's great. Right? I love that part.
Got a That's diving board. Thing.
What was that?
It's got a diving board.
Yeah. It's awesome. But that, you know, the so that all started, the history behind gold in the vault started in Sumer. So if you've ever read something in the Bible about the Sumerians, it's what is it, Basra? The Sumer? Is that right? Southern Iraq. Anyways, the Sumerians, they were the first ones where people came along and said, well, don't carry your gold around. Someone's going to rob you. So why don't you put gold in the vault? I'll take care of it. I'll give you a little piece of paper that shows that you own the gold on this shelf. And then one day it's like, hey, nobody comes in for their gold. They just exchange their pieces of paper, right? Then someone's like, this is fabulous. This is awesome. Nobody knows how much gold I'm actually holding, because everyone just keeps trading their pieces of paper. No one knows anything about anything. So then they're like, we can lend this out too. So anyways, that's where money came from. It was 1971 when the United States got off the gold standard. By the way, how about this for a history lesson? When World War II ended, they got together. The United States had 50% of the world's GDP. Think about how rich an American was. 50% of the entire GDP, and had 80% of all the gold in the world in Fort Knox. Huh? Amazing. How much gold do we have now? None. There's no gold in Fort Knox.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it hasn't been gold in Fort Knox since 1968. That's why by the time 71 came along, Nixon had to take it off the gold standard. The French pushed it, by the way. Do you guys know that story? Yeah, Nixon's in charge, and they were bullying the Europeans over something. And France is like, bullshit. So they're like, okay, give us our gold. Because they had U.S. dollars, which were exchangeable for gold. So, hey. We got, you know, the French had, I don't know, let's say 800 billion in paper money, U.S. dollars. Like, okay, cool. Just give us the gold. We're cool. Just, we'll give you your cash back. We'd like our gold. Well, there was a problem. Like, whoops, wait, we don't have that gold. We slowly sold it off, right? So anyways, so we got off the gold standard. Pretty funny. All right, so not a lot of change out of investing in China, a little bit of change in investing in Europe. Americans are still going to buy the U.S. stock market. And, oh, yeah, emerging markets way up. And that's yield chasing. But the problem with yield, if you, this, you know, I said something before, like yield is kind of dead, you know, so chasing it is kind of silly. The only way you can get yield, of course, is risk. If it was a deal, someone would have arbitraged you out of it. If investing in the South Africa was risk-free, but you would earn 6%, you're like, shoot, well, I'll just do that. And then South Africa wouldn't have to pay 6%. If everyone wanted to do it, they would rather pay 4%. They'd rather pay 3%. So you're always getting the right price. And you're always going to get the right yield, because it's the same thing, right? you're only getting a high yield because you're paying less. So it's whatever, how you want to look at it. I think the world should look at, you know, what could I trade? You know, how can I take advantage of volatility to earn from the trading business, not from earning yield? Because I think that's, I think we're, it's going to be a long time before we go back to a normal world. Right? Like, how does the Fed get out of its situation that we're in? How do you get out of quantitative easing? When will the Fed raise interest rates? Remember when they jacked interest rates up to 2% recently? And they had to draw it down all the way back. So, like, when are we going to go to, you know, when I was a currency trader, my PayPal account had like a high yield savings account. And I think I was making like $6,000 a month on my PayPal account. It was crazy. When are we going to get to a point where I can earn 5.5, 6, 7% by owning a bond or being in a high yield money market account? Like, that's all it was, this PayPal account. But I had like 300,000 in it or something. And I realized at the end of the year, like, that's actually pretty good money. It was like five grand a month or whatever. It was just really crazy. And then, of course, all of that has long since gone away. But it's going to be hard to earn that kind of income. So we're going to have to, like, trade assets, one cash flow to another cash flow, I think, until the central banks stop manipulating the bond market. And when is that going to happen? Right? If the Bank of Japan have been in this scenario for 30 years, I mean, the Japanese are not stupid. So they're, you know, you get stuck. And I think that's going to be the greatest question of the next couple of decades, is whether we get stuck, we paint ourselves in a corner, and all of a sudden, you know, there's no way out of this. And Japan is definitely in that situation. If I'm right, if I'm even remotely close, like, let's say the 50% of the Nikkei is owned by the Bank of Japan, or 30%, like, I'm going from 70, let's say, to 35%. So let's say I'm way wrong, it's only 35%. But how does the central bank get out of that? I don't think you can. And that's a problem. Capitalism says you should just let banks fail, not banks, but in this case, they must have bought stocks in companies that had some sort of value to the society other than producing a product and a service in exchange for cash, right? They kept these zombie companies alive for whatever reason. But now you can't get out. And I think that was going to be a big mistake. Cool. Oh, I want to see if there's how much time until the stock market opens? Oh, we got a bit. We got some time. Let's see if there's a you know what we haven't done, actually? We haven't read this week's Barons. So let's just skip last week. Last week, there was an interview with some professional fund manager. And he buys tech stocks. Like, dude. Well, that's what you do. I own Google and Apple. Oh, gee whiz. All right, let's see what we got, Barons. Better impress me, Barons. Pay over $10 a month and I get $20 worth of paper. Oh, I'm not going to read it, but here's an article right here. First article. Are rising yields a good sign or a warning for the economy? Might be interesting read. I'm not going to do it. Let's see. All right. So I like to start with the numbers. And like I've been telling you, it's also a podcast now. You can subscribe to The Numbers by Bloomberg. Let's see. All right. What is the average FICO credit score in America? Now, I think it goes as high as 800 or something, 820, 830. I don't know what the top is. Does anybody know? Up is 850, 825, 850. Yeah. Well, this one says 711. It's actually not that bad, is it? Can you buy a house with that kind of credit? I don't know. You probably could, couldn't you? Yeah, yeah. So that's good. I mean, it depends on how you get the numbers, right? So, for example, we now know, and we were talking, Mike and I were talking about this earlier, where we now know there's a relationship between the central bank and whether the stock market goes up. We know when the economy is in trouble, the Fed's going to come in and do something like lower interest rates. And then when they can't do that anymore, they're going to start quantitative easing of some sort. And asset prices will go up. Only 50% of Americans participate in the stock market, which to me is just unbelievable. Jim Cramer talks about when he was homeless, living out of the back of a car, he still put $50 into a mutual fund. Like 8 years later, he's vice president of Goldman Sachs. Like, really? How did you do that? But he always put money aside. How do we change that? Are we able to change that? I mean, there's a PhD to make, to think about the research. Like, how do you get more people to participate? Yeah, and obviously education is the way to do it. But how, I'd like to see more of it for sure.
There was somebody, I can't remember who it was. It's a Peter Lynch type person, someone in that genre or whatever. But he suggested that every American child should be given $50,000 at birth from the government.
Oh, the baby bonds. Yeah, baby bonds. Yeah.
And then by the time they retired, they would be a millionaire. You can't touch it until then. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think it's the duty of, a grandparent, for example, if you can, instead of buying all the junk or whatever we typically buy, like, sorry, kids, no more Christmas, but I'll do you better, right? Right. I'll give you a $20 Amazon.com gift card. You can buy whatever you want, but I'm going to put money into an account for you. And when I'm going to lock it till you're 30. And when you're 30, right, boom, that's my gift to you. And that money will grow and multiply exponentially for 30 years right off the bat. You know, imagine if you carried out, compound interest from the point a baby's born. What if you tied that into their retirement? So they hit, by the time that happens, you'll have to be 72 before you're allowed to retire. But what'll happen is that money becomes available and they're like, hey, congratulations, you have $48 million in your retirement account. You're like, really? Yeah. And then the government will tax you. But still, it'd be a very important thing in life. We spend too much on a lot of our holidays, I think. Halloween is ridiculous how much money we spend even on Halloween. I'm like, no, but congratulations, I put $500 in your retirement account, but that's the other thing I think a parent can do or should do or should consider, let their kids borrow to go to school. Going to school is very expensive. And I think a lot less people are going to get a university education 25 years from now than currently. But if you can send them to college, send them to college. But the thing is, let them take out low interest loans for that from the government, because it'll always be there. I would assume it's going to always be there. But when they graduate, maybe with their graduate degree, force them to get as much education as possible. But say, when you get your master's degree, I will buy your first home. because by then you'll probably have found another smart, educated person who's beautiful, and you're going to fall in love with them. You want to spend the rest of your life with them, and you're going to want to reproduce and all that kind of stuff. But don't waste your savings on saving, right? You know how many people in California are, you know, like 40 and they're still saving for their first house? It's crazy because they have to pay $5,000 a month for a two-bedroom apartment. And you need $400,000 as a down payment? Like, nobody makes that kind of money anymore. But wouldn't it be great if you forced your kids to get a massive quality education? They have this long debt, sure, but a low-interest government loans. And then you're like, I bought your first home, which means they're already jumping probably 10 or 15 years ahead into the cycle. Now they'll, right? And now instead of paying off a mortgage, they're saving to trade up, if you will. And that what happens is it changes the course of their children's lives and so forth. And by the time they're 70, they've had a whole completely different life. It, just based on as simple as they're not saving for a down payment, and while they're doing it, paying rent, they skip all of that and they get right to the appreciation point, and then they can save that money for other things or invest that money somewhere else, like a small apartment building or whatever, some sort of capitalist entrepreneurial endeavor. But it changes the course of people's lives. Right now we spend all our money on what? Healthcare, home, and paying off our school loans. And then you work your whole life and then pay off your school loans, and then it goes dark. You're like, wow. No coughing, Jim. Especially when I'm making death jokes. Come on, man. That's yeah, it's like that whiskey in the coffee cup. I get it. All right, cool. So yeah, so honestly, like when I've studied different periods of people's lives, like when smaller, I mean, that's a big thing, right? I mean, that's a big thing to buy someone's house. But you should start saving for that when you're 30, because your daddy bought you a house. And, you know, anyways, it can change the course of your family's history for 1,000 years. So you got to find a way. You need to be the remarkable one if you can, and start young and save for that, and then change the destiny of your entire family. But whatever. Whatever. Just me babbling on. It's only money. Remember, money is an illusion. So you got to put the money to work. There's a lot of people that are still in cash. So they think it's risk-free. They're not in the stock market. It's not risk-free. Okay, if the economy improves, what happens? The stock market goes up, right? As we just talked about. So you missed all of that. But inflation goes up, which means now you're losing 2% a year, and you're not earning any income on it from your bank account. Because by the time you're like, you collect your interest payments on your bank account cash, and then they're like, oh, we're going to charge you $2 in fees. And you're like, you just killed all my income. Right. So you're like, cash is bad. So you gotta do something with it. And ideally something that earns income. In that case, or you can invest it into real estate and then give it to your kids or your grandkids. And you can't imagine, if you've raised your kids properly and kept them off drugs, 1,000 years from now, what the family will be like. But someone's got to be the hero and do it first. All right. Hang on. I'm seeing if there's anything in this, Barons. There's lots of stuff. If you guys are going to subscribe to anything, I'd say Barons. Just because it's all money related. All right, let's see. I'm trying to see.
You that spoke about the difference between the Rockefellers and the Vanderbilts.
Well, the difference, like what they did and their period in time. Like Vanderbilt was definitely entrepreneur. Okay, so he grew up poor on, wasn't the Mississippi? I think it was on the Ohio River. And he bought a boat, and then he bought a different boat. And that's when you use boats to move things around up and down the rivers, right? Transportation. And he went from poor to owning a boat, owning a second boat, owning a third boat, to being a multimillionaire. Even in his own time, I think he was a millionaire. Which in, what are we talking about, 1830, 1840? Like, that's pretty good money. And then he took the whole thing, sold all his boats, went to cash, and invested everything in the railroads. Because apparently being a millionaire when everyone else is making a dollar a day isn't good enough. He must have been an interesting dude. But then there were too many railroads, and he suffered. Because now you don't make money unless people are moving freight on your railroad lines, and you're charging them access, right? So then he cut a deal with a starving oil refiner named Rockefeller. And Vanderbilt and Rockefeller worked together. They were both starving on the brink of bankruptcy. Like Rockefeller was literally, he and his family were living in a dirt floor house, if you want to call it that. I don't know what part of the country it was, Ohio maybe. But anyways, they were like, you know, kids didn't have shoes on their feet kind of thing. Like times were tough back then, but they were struggling. And he had put everything in this oil refinery business and it wasn't doing well at all. And he was on the brink of bankruptcy. And then you had Vanderbilt that put all his millions in, was losing it all. So they cut a deal to work together to get give each other a better deal. Because if you produced let's say you refined oil into gasoline, you had to ship it somewhere. That's how just how it worked. But if the railroad guys knew that you needed them, then they would overcharge you. So anyway, so Rockefeller and Vanderbilt got together because they needed each other. They were right at the brink of desperation and bankruptcy. They cut a deal. And then Rockefeller refined crude oil into kerosene. So you always hear that he's a big oil man. No, he's not. Kerosene. He was in truly an Illuminati. Kerosene was used to make light. So imagine New York City before kerosene, where everyone had candles in their apartment buildings. You like to sit in your apartment at night in the pitch black? It's not very cool, right? So anyway, so they got kerosene lamps going. And then, of course, Rockefeller was genius because a lot of people made really bad products back then. There was no standardization. There was no quality control and safety. So you could buy kerosene and the thing would explode because it was too much like gasoline. And it would just explode and burn you alive and burn down your house. So Rockefeller standardized it and created the standard oil company, but they made kerosene. The reason he called it oil is they were replacing a different product. You guys know what that product was? A wink, wink, nudge, nudge, oil. What were they replacing? Whale oil. Yeah. So how did Rockefeller become filthy, stinking rich then? What was the major thing that changed for him?
He had the ships, didn't he?
Well, he got more into the railroads and had more and more deals with Vanderbilt. That's why Vanderbilt got so rich. So pretty soon it was all Rockefeller moving things, and he would bully his way in and buy more refineries to make more kerosene, because then you would have, you know, better economies of scale, and he controlled that process. But what happened was we went into the Civil War in the 1860s, and the North, what's the word, not confiscated, but the U.S. government seized the oil whaling ships to use as transportation because they used all the naval ships for the blockade. So they're like, now we need to move stuff around. So they took over all the whaling ships to move cargo and use their supply chain. Commandeered, yeah, that might be the right word. And so all of a sudden there was no kerosene. Well, no, sorry. There was no whale oil. And the whaling business went out of business. And then they're like, oh, well, you can use this kerosene. And they're like, really? Can you imagine if suddenly every person in America wants and needs you. It's sort of like the Jeff Bezos of the time, where you're like, you can sit in the dark, right? Or you could buy some kerosene in a kerosene lamp and have light. You can use the kerosene that might explode and burn you alive while you're sleeping, or you can buy standardized oil, right? In this case, standard oil. And so it's sort of like, well, you can go to the grocery store and possibly get sick and die, or you can just order stuff on Amazon. Yep. Jeff Bezos, what did he make? He made $1 billion a day for 30 days in a row or something. You know, or was it more? It was like 10 billion. I mean, it was crazy what Bezos made in March and April, wasn't it? It was crazy. He made like an extra $100 billion or something personally, not in sales, him personally. So anyway, so yeah, there's a history there. Okay, I didn't see any amazing interview at the end of that, Barron's, and then I didn't see one last week. It was just some idiot that makes way too much money because he buys Google stock. You believe like people call that a career? What'd you do today? It was crazy, man. I totally thought about buying some more Google stock, but I already own a bunch of Google stock. So I decided not to buy Google stock. Well, what else do you? Well, I seriously thought about Netflix. Ooh, here's some more polls. Maybe we can do trivia. Describe your investment outlook for U.S. equities in the next 12 months. 54% bullish, 33% neutral, 13% bearish. Now check this out. I think if you did research and found out how many people actually trade short, it's probably 13%, right? Like, I like the neutral idea. That's the dangerous one. 33% of professional investors essentially say they don't know. I'm like, well, why are you a professional investor then? To me, that's pretty scary. You can't be neutral. What do you mean neutral? I mean, I guess if you had to pick one, but still. Yeah. So anyways, that's interesting. 44% of these people believe the market is overvalued. But what does that mean? It means it's going to go up. So yes, you're paying too much, but it's because it's going up. So overvalued doesn't mean it's going to fall. It's a tough psychological thing for most investors, especially the ones that don't use technical analysis. You have to always pay too much. And this is absolutely true in real estate. You get 10 people together, who buys the building? 10 people are negotiating over a building. Who gets to own it? The person that paid the most. So it's overvalued because everyone looked at you and they're like, really? So how can you be a good professional investor? Let's say in real estate. It comes down to your borrowing costs. Okay, so if everyone else had to pay investors 12% to buy an apartment building, that's what it's called a look back provision. So you put it in the contract where you say, we're going to guarantee you a 12% return, and it's going to trickle in over time. And then when we sell the property, we're going to look back and see how much money you made, and then we're going to make you whole on the 12%. So you're going to get 12%. But what if you had investors that said 8% was enough because they like you, you always make good decisions, you never make a mistake, you never come back asking for more money? Well, now you can buy more, you can pay more. It's not because you paid too much, but because you have better clients, better structured deal, you're less risky, you're a smarter investor, whatever, but your cost of borrowing is lower. But at the end of the day, you have to pay more than other people are willing. But most people can't afford it because they've made poor decisions in the past. Name the stock you considered the most overvalued. All right, here you go. What do you guys think?
Tesla.
Tesla, and that is the answer. Yep, recent price, $461. The next one was Zoom, then Snowflake, all the way down to Apple.
Didn't Tesla just split also?
What's that?
Yeah, I think
Tesla split just split also.
I still can't hear that.
I think Tesla was twice as overvalued because it just split.
Oh, I see. Yeah, yeah. Okay. It doesn't matter. It's still their answer, right? That was the number one, according to the survey, overvalued in people's opinion. Let's do another one. Which asset class do you consider most attractive today? Equities, gold, cash, real estate, commodities, treasuries, non-US bonds, or other? Which asset class do you consider most attractive? What do you think they said?
Like commodities?
Equities, gold, cash, real estate, commodities, treasuries.
Who is being polled again?
Professional money managers. Big investors, institutional investors. Let's see if they actually defined it. It's the big money poll. So whatever that means. Big money. All right. Equity is number one, by far, like by far, by far, like they're really, really putting money into equities, but that's what most people do.
Interesting.
Gold is a distant second. Okay. And then cash is third, which just shows you, it just shows you that even though these guys are institutional and even though these guys are big money managers, honestly, they're not that smart. We look up to them and I think we idolize them or romanticize them that they're the smart money and they sit in this big office in Wall Street and they have access to information that nobody has and we cannot beat these guys, right? They're all Harvard assholes. They probably are all Harvard assholes, but they're not that bright. Because that, like, number three is cash. That's just stupid. But that's what they said. Okay, real estate way down there. I guess they're because of COVID. But, okay, don't buy a skyscraper in Manhattan. I mean, that's actually an interesting thing. What's going to happen to New York City? What's going to happen to London? You know, like, when you don't need to be there anymore? Rent. By the way, that $5,000 two-bedroom apartment in San Francisco, I'm actually talking about someone specific. A young guy that's living there now, I know, and he just talked to his landlord. It's $5,000 something for his two-bedroom apartment, and it's not fancy. He's not at the penthouse skyscraper or something. It's just a apartment, okay? $5,000. He's renegotiated it for $2,800. Booyah. Because you don't need to live near work anymore. You don't need to be in the center of town anymore. By the way, housing prices in suburbs around New York are up 60% since COVID. Single family homes within driving distance of New York City are up 60%. But apartments and apartment rents in the city are plummeting. Because now you can just commute from home when you need to, otherwise you're just going to work from home. So what's going to happen in New York City 100 years from now? I don't know. I hope the history remains there. All right, so let's see the economy. Let's see how predict the U.S. growth rate. Oh, I don't want to do that one. In what year will U.S. GDP return to 2019 levels, pre-COVID levels? When will the U.S. economy hit $2.1 trillion in GDP? 22, 21, after 22. This year, next year, or beyond?
22.
57%. Remember, I talked about it 6 months ago. I thought early next year we're going to have like, you know, 6 or 7% GDP. Remember, because it's comparative. So if you go through GDP, let's say last year was negative 2%, and next year is plus 2%, but what's the difference between the two, right? Like there's going to be a huge percentage increase and all that kind of stuff. But if COVID-19 stays tolerable, or if we can, I mean, we have better treatments now. If we can get, I don't know if you can ever get a cure for such thing. I mean, we haven't cured influenza. What's going to stop COVID-2021? You know, like, I don't know, but if we can find a way to live with it, then yeah, we'll just move back on to what we were doing. All right, so that's that. Let's see if there's anything else here. It's actually a pretty thin, I mean, I can't say pretty thin. There's like lots of articles that are worth reading in here, but not reading out loud. So you should maybe, you guys should get a subscription for a little while and see if you guys like it. So here's this guy on stocks. He buys high-tech stocks. Let's see if he says, I'm trying to see if there's anything here. Talking about Corona. What's a big trend? Okay. What's a big trend you're watching? Perhaps the most important thing in the last 5 to 10 years is the rise of the platform company, company that sits between two users. Okay, gotcha. Great. And boom, just not saying it. U.S.-China relations have been deteriorating. What do you foresee? The China situation goes well beyond the trade concerns we had last year. It's a philosophical issue in terms of the way the two countries want to run their governments. Do they, okay, he's not going to say anything. So, like, the philosophical difference, like, we're facing a philosophical difference right now, and that has to do with, are you going to vote for the Democrats or the Republicans? Both parties have reasonably intelligent people involved. They could probably put together a White House, but what's the philosophical difference? Okay, either way, they're capitalist. Okay, there's one that favors growth and productivity increases through business and jobs. Then there's more of a European model that looks at the distribution of income. By the way, can you guys still hear me? Just kind of went quiet one ear. All right, cool. So to me, there isn't a right or wrong. There's a difference. That's all. And living in a democracy, it's kind of cool that you can shift back and forth. So I think, like Ray Dalio, for example, his big thing these days, because he's a macroeconomist like us. And so the way he looks at it is the prime concern in the United States isn't our form of capitalism, because we'll always go back and forth, ebb and flow, boom and bust. But it's the income disparity that creates problems. And we had income disparity back in the 1930s. So there's another sort of situation where the central bank lowered interest rates to zero, then they monetized the debt. And at that same time, like if you imagine the roaring 20s, some people got fabulously wealthy, but most people did not live like the Great Gatsby, right? It was pretty modest times, right? most people just suffered through World War One and, you know, had a pretty meager life. But some people were fabulously wealthy. And then remember, there was no income tax. So the difference here and what would Ray Dalio was pushing for is how do we solve the problem where the natural inclination of our time and similar in other times is that the left go more left, the right go more right, the rich get richer, the poor get left out, and then we're at our throats politically, economically, socially. There's no connection between us, right? Like that's the bigger threat to productivity and income growth, which we all at the end of the day want. That's what I was saying, where look, if it's so easy, like going back to Mike's conversation, like if it's so easy, if we know the government is going to push up the stock market, why wouldn't you buy the stock market? Like it's free money. It truly is free money. Why wouldn't you do it? But 50% of people don't own it, even in good times. Like, why don't you do that? So then there's, you know, is it an education? Is it a social thing? Or why is there a disconnect? How do we break down that disconnect? It might be the solution. But like the government gave away $3 trillion. Right? Do you remember that? They're like, COVID, what do we do? How about $3 trillion? Cool. But it didn't go to half the country. Should you care? And if you do care, what is the role of the government? Is there a time when you have to have a distribution? But see, I think it's dangerous to give somebody money. And I think we've proven the welfare state fails. It's worse than poverty because it entraps you and future generations are impoverished, right? So, I mean, there's a time to help when like, okay, times are tough right now. Here's $3,000, but you can't just keep doing it. $3,000, $3,000, $3,000, $3,000. And all of a sudden, right? So we have to be able to live with each other, like each other, work well together, be concerned for each other. But there has to be, you know, that comes from, I think, a reliance on each other to be productive. And from the productivity of us working together and playing well together, that we can then have an economy that provides, right? To me, I'm a capitalist. So I'm always going to go that direction where you're like, you don't want to give someone money, you want to give them a job. Now, there are times when they need the money and you're like, dude, I don't need a job, I don't need a lecture, but my kids need to eat tonight. Oh, well, we can give you a tax rebate. They're like, F you, I need money like tonight, or I get kicked out of my apartment, or my kids won't eat again, right? So we have to find a way to redistribute. Now, the funny thing at Harvard is I wrote like a 20-page paper on the improved, where it does take some money from the top and does put it on the bottom, but the money that goes, let's say, to the bottom 5%, like forget about the top 1% and stuff. Let's talk about the most needy of the, you know, how do you address that? And there are so many broken down parts of that system, you know, the education, the family unit, so on and so forth. Even diet is really tied to income and stuff. And I thought a pretty clever way. I think, because one of the things I had to study to get to that point was universal basic income, UBI. It's kind of an interesting thought that Friedman was most, I think, attached to. And there are some strengths and weaknesses to his thought. Some of his theories back then have now been disproven. It just doesn't quite work that way. So if you can get a, so I remember part of my plan was I would have a taxation that was a higher, but the interesting thing is I would pay low-income families to have one adult. So I tied marriage into it, not for religion, but because a family unit is stronger that way. That's been proven. And then what you do is, instead, you know, you pay someone to stay home, make sure the kids have a healthy diet, make sure the kids are are doing their homework, making sure the kids get a ride or escorted to ballet class, but to make sure that that family unit was there, and you'd pay that person. Like, it's amazing that domestic workers, you know, lack of a better word, a housewife, is still not included in GDP. But it should be, I think. There's a true social value to it. Like, you can look at the cost. Like, another example is, you know, how do you keep a kid in school who's disenfranchised with education, has a breakdown of the family unit? What's the percentage likelihood that they're going to be incarcerated sometime in their life? And it's really huge. And you might be able to invest, let's say, $20,000 into getting them a better education versus $130,000 a year to keep them in jail when they're 20, right? So, like, how do you invest a little bit better so you don't end into that vicious cycle?
Do you think the answer might be in your business enterprises that the various stakeholders, being labor, being founders, and being the investors, that they had, those three groups had a more equal share in the profits of the enterprise versus,
One of the things I remember was key in my plan was the government had to play an active role in creating an entrepreneurial society and culture. Like, at the time, Uber was frowned upon by the government, right? You remember those days? You'd go to the airport and you're like, you're not supposed to be using Uber, right? I'm like, why? You can work whenever you want. You can work flex hours, you can work days, you can work nights, you can work 3 hours here, 2 hours there. In between, you're taking care of the kids, or you're, you know, I mean, for example, single women need a lot more flex time in their careers because they tend to take care of the kids, but they also tend to take care of the old folks, and they're doing all this extra stuff where men just do 9 to 5 and they climb the ladder and they're like, yeah, look at me, I'm CEO, right? Like, so flex time and being like a programmer, being a driver, being a lawnmower, but can have a flex schedule to do these things, I think was really important. And maybe not necessarily redistributing the income, but providing unlimited opportunity, unlimited equal access. And to have like an entrepreneurial culture that says, look, you can do anything you want and we'll help you do it. Right? Like that kind of attitude. Like back in the Silicon Valley, when I arrived in the Silicon Valley in the early 90s, you could write a business plan on a piece of paper and show it to someone. They're like, I'll back you on that. You need to go do that. Right? But imagine if we had a culture, maybe the government was providing not just education, but entrepreneurial education. Like, kids come out of high school and they can't balance a checkbook. They can't do cash flow statements. No, but they can draw, they can do calculus, but they can't calculate, right? So it'd be interesting if we had, like, if we said as a society, look, 90% of people don't need a college education. 90% of people need a quality education, right? And if we tied that into learning in high school how to create businesses, how to run small businesses, how to manage people. How many people get a management job and they've never managed before and they don't have a management background? They're like, well, you're the new manager. And I don't know anything about managing, right? So what if everyone knew a little bit? Like, what if high school was a mini MBA? And the whole point was these kids are going to come out and either work intelligently as an intrapreneur, making companies more effective in their processes, or be an entrepreneur and, like, you should run your own shop, your own business. You should, you know, you should whatever, be, you control your own destiny, right? And I, as an entrepreneur, I love that. So, like I said, I gave advice to my gardener after COVID, actually, and things are tough. And I'm like, this is when you expand. No joke. I'm like, this is when you need to find others that are contracting and that would sell some of their route, or they'll sell some of their equipment because they laid off their guys. Buy the equipment cheap, get another trailer, get some more mowers, get some more blowers, right? Find people that, right? And then hustle and get new clients and expand. So when things normalize again, you'll have more routes. You have three routes instead of your one, but you got to expand when times are tough. When everyone's contracting, get big. We know that's natural, right? Right? This, the animal universe does that. When you're under threat, you get big or you run. Don't run. Everyone's running. Get big. Expand. And he comes back to me like last week and he's like, I took your advice and I got these other routes. I hired a bunch of guys. I got more equipment. Things are going good. I'm like, nice. But why don't they teach that in school? You know, I gave him a lifelong lesson. Now, I shared it in 3 minutes, which is great, but it took me a life to learn that, right? So I think if we had a government that built purposely entrepreneurialism and then had programs behind it to support it, that's how you do it. Anyone can do anything they want and have the government back them up. I think that's how to do it. And then, of course, the family unit has to be strong, right? I think that's really, as far as stable relationships and growth for children, it's nice to, children tend to do better when there's not so much drama in the house, right? Mom and dad screaming at each other, dad's not around at all, half the brothers and sisters are on drugs or whatever, and you're like, oh my God, how do you take that kid? Right now, that kid, that there's one kid in a million that is really brilliant and they find their way out of that situation despite everything. But there's a lot of really smart kids that maybe are above average kids that could go on and live above average life, but they're stuck in that mess. And that, so that's why I'm like, we need to fix that too. And that's not just one sort of a cultural neighborhood. That's all of America. Right? All of America. I'm scared to death of drugs. Oh my God. Right? That's my number one concern with my kids is drugs. Because I know people that had fabulous, smart, intelligent, vibrant, inquisitive children, and they're fucked when they hit their 20s. I mean, dead, worthless. Not dead, but by and large, worthless. And they were brilliant, awesome, incredible little children. Drugs. That's it. It's over. So that scares me. So we got to get that out of life and society. I mean, I must talk to my kids every day, probably every close to every day about drugs. Doesn't expand your mind. So anyways. So yeah, we got lots of challenges. The market's open, so that's not a challenge anymore. So I hope you guys have trade plans. This is off the charts, which means we don't talk about technicals, fundamentals, trader psychology, the market in general, that kind of stuff. This is just us getting together as a group and hanging out. But now you have to go to work. Markets are open. You should already have your plans trade, your trades planned. And if not, you better hustle. Like, don't go to your chart and throw down a trade. Honestly, in our live group, we get together on Thursday and we have this all planned out. We know prices that we're interested in and zones and what we know what we want to do at certain prices. So you should already know if you wanted to sell that euro dollar or not. And this is a confirmation. And if you were going to buy it, you probably bought it Friday at the market close. Right? So now it's time for execution. So I will bid you adieu. I will thank you for your time. I hope this was interesting and fun. I like hanging with you guys. But like I said, my number one goal is to entice you to be at your charts at the exact right time. Because I hate it when I'm on Forex.today. I'm like, see, if you're there at the first hour of the first week, you had a great, beautiful trade. Where were you? So now you're here. You're in the most important hour of your week as a swing trader. So if you know how to swing trade, you already got it planned out. You might already be in, or you're going to be in the next few minutes. If you don't know how to swing trade, fxbootcamp.com. That's it. It's going to cost you money. You're going to have to put some time into it, but you have to know. If you don't know how, there is no hope. Okay. If you don't know how, there isn't any hope. You're not going to get lucky. You're not going to just figure it out. It's not going to come to you in a dream. An angel won't come down through the clouds and like, you should swing trade. The knowledge is there. Like, why fight it? Seriously, why fight it? Just do it. So there are people here that know. They'll tell you, get on board and, you know, drink the Kool-Aid and ask for a second cup. Faster is better. So I will see you guys tomorrow at forex.today. Thank you for being part of this community, and have a wonderful evening. I'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks, Wayne.
Thanks, Wayne. Great way to start off the week.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it'll take me 10 minutes to actually shut the webinar off, but I'll see you guys tomorrow. Cheers.
Thanks, Wayne.